Hello, my name is Sean Raphael. I'm the referee in chief for BC Hockey, and this video is meant to inform everybody of the upcoming rule changes and modifications that have been made for the 2018 season that will be in effect until the end of the 2020 season. This is the new signal for too many players on the ice, indicated with six fingers, open palm, and single finger in front of the chest of the official, and will be used when reporting penalties at the scorekeeper box and during the penalty calling procedure. In addition to existing rule 3.6 under protective equipment, when a goaltender loses their helmet or facial protector, and now blocker or trapper, play shall be stopped immediately unless there's an imminent scoring chance. Any such deliberate action by the goaltender shall result in a minor penalty for delay of game, and if this deliberate action of removing the helmet or facial protector and now blocker or trapper occurs while an opponent is on a breakaway, or it occurs in the last 2 minutes of regular playing time, there will be a penalty shot assessed. In this situation, the goaltender inadvertently loses their trapper, and we would have play stopped immediately as this is not deemed an imminent scoring chance. Stopping play immediately is for the sake of safety of the goaltender, that they're not attempting to stop the puck without a protective piece of equipment. On the second play, you'll see the shot on net. The goaltender inadvertently loses their trapper. Should that wraparound go in the net, that would be deemed an imminent scoring chance and that goal would stand. However, when the play goes back to the point, it is no longer an imminent scoring chance, and we would have a stoppage of play for the loss of trapper. And under rule 4.13, calling of penalties, anytime a team becomes shorthanded by a time penalty being put on the clock, the ensuing faceoff will take place in the defending zone of the team that has become shorthanded. However, there are four exceptions to the faceoff location. One, when a penalty is assessed after the scoring of a goal, the faceoff will take place at center ice. When a penalty is assessed at the end or before the start of a period, the faceoff will also take place at center ice. Three, when a gathering occurs, which is both point players or any player coming from the bench from the attacking team entering deeply into the zone beyond the top of the circles, the faceoff will go into the neutral zone and the nearest faceoff location outside the blue line. And when the non-offending team clears the puck for icing, that will result in the faceoff coming down to the defending zone of the team that iced the puck and then go to the neutral zone outside the blue line. Enhancement to Rule 6.5, head contact. In minor and female, any player incurring three head contact penalties that do not meet the criteria of a major in game misconduct or match penalty shall be assessed a game ejection. Note, a double minor penalty assessed under Rule 6.5C will be treated as one penalty. Therefore, if a player has received a minor penalty for head contact and a double minor penalty for head contact already within a game, they need to receive a third minor or double minor penalty for head contact in order to be assessed the game ejection. Two significant changes have occurred to Rule 7.4, tripping under the slew footing criteria. Note specifically, the game misconduct has been removed from the double minor option under this rule. In this clip here, you'll see two players battling in front of the net where a slew foot action is applied. This will be considered a double minor penalty for slew footing, and no longer will a game misconduct accompany that penalty. So this example is a double minor penalty for tripping under the slew footing criteria. Should an injury occur from any action deemed to be a slew foot, the match penalty will be assessed. In clip two, the second significant change is the consideration of a player being in motion. If a player is in motion, the referee will have discretion based upon the degree of violence whether or not a match penalty will be assessed. In this situation, the player delivering the slew foot was in motion, but no injury resulted, and it's not with a high degree of violence, therefore the referee has the discretion to call the double minor penalty. However, if an injury occurs, they can call a match penalty. In the next clip, there is a high degree of impact with the ice upon the application of the slew foot. Regardless of the player being in motion or not, a match penalty will be assessed due to the degree of violence. In the final clip here, you'll see the stick of the player contact their opponent in the back of the skates and not a slew footing action. Therefore, this is a tripping penalty, minor. Rule 7.4, tripping, the five criteria for calling a penalty shot when a player is on a breakaway. The stipulation of a player being fouled from behind has the additional concept of being fouled by the goaltender. In this clip, you will see a player that meets all the criteria of a penalty shot being in possession and control of the puck within the neutral or attacking zone with no player between them and the goaltender and being denied a reasonable scoring opportunity, but instead of being fouled from behind, they are otherwise fouled by the goaltender. This will now qualify for the assessment of a penalty shot.